Hello and welcome to Time to Wonder, the online faith show here at Leaven Online, where you never know what's coming next. It's been put together under some time pressure, which is why you're going to hear more of me than you will see, but I cannot but think that's a good thing. Audio is quicker to edit than video, if you follow me. I did think about having a chat with Boadicea, but she was busy organising a raid on a Roman garrison, so maybe some other time when we might be glad of a historical perspective on strong nationalist leaders. Like so many of her kind, she was pretty good at destroying things. Not so great on the reconstruction or the reconciliation. Who does that remind you of, historically and right now? There's quite a bit about race in this week's programme, as Christians, along with others, have been trying to respond to the Black Lives Matter protests. There'll be some stuff about climate change too, along with why the Bishop of Ripon has been getting death threats. And I'm mostly editing material from various video sources, but I also have some thoughts to share with you about conspiracy theories as hatched to explain COVID-19, among other things. It's all because of Brexit, you know, a divine punishment for voting Leave. Well, is that any more ridiculous than suggesting he's punishing humanity as a whole because some of them are homosexual, as an Israeli diplomat has suggested? Maybe God has got it in for gays. Some versions of God certainly have, if not the one I believe in, but surely he would smite more selectively than this. Anyway, I'm Richard Bradshaw and you're not, but maybe that's just what they want you to think. Why should anyone threaten to kill the Bishop of Ripon? Well, she's a woman, which not everyone approves of. I mean, being a bishop as well as being a woman. But the Bishop of Worcester has been similarly threatened and he isn't remotely female. The background is a discussion in the Anglican Synod about Dominic Cummings' visit to Durham during lockdown and his questionable defence of this at a time when many other people were staying indoors, as per government instructions. A number of bishops were quite vocal in their criticism, which then led to a debate about whether and how far the church should be involved in politics. The sort of people who even asked the question could do with reading just a little bit of church history. The church has been involved in politics from day one, for example, in its refusal to acknowledge the supreme authority of Roman emperors as divine, which got them into big trouble. Two old chestnuts come to mind, the first the one about the Church of England as the Tory party at prayer, and the other about trades unionism owing more to Methodism than Marx. There is some truth and some exaggeration in both, but they each point to a linkage that no theologian, no mainstream Christian leader of any denomination right now has ever denied. We're in the throes of a US election campaign that will be decided by the evangelical vote, the religious right. I won't call it Christian because that begs a question I've raised before on this programme. The president of Poland is hoping to get re-elected on a programme that includes opposition to gay rights, to sex education, to abortion and birth control, and is strongly supported by the Catholic hierarchy. So the question is not, and never has been, about whether Christians should be involved in politics, but in what way they should be, and when their involvement strays into the unacceptably partisan. For some Anglicans, the direct criticism of a central government figure, in this case Dominic Cummings, crossed a boundary. And that is a point of view. What is not on any possible grounds justifiable, but not least that of sheer ignorance of church history, is the threat to stay out of politics or we'll kill you, sent to the bishops of both Worcester and Ripon. It cannot have come from any Christian source, but whoever sent it knows and may even care enough about what Christians say to have been following events at Synod. All of which sends out an ominous smoke signal about the kind of country we may be becoming. Hope not, but anyway, here's some music with Howard Goodall and a new setting of some familiar words.
Thank you.
Before lockdown, I had never been to a webinar. I would not have known what a webinar is. It's kind of like a Zoom meeting, except you can only see the speakers. They can't see you. And if you want to communicate with them, you have to use the chat facility. You're going to see clips from two. The first from the Christian Churches Together in Britain and Ireland website, which I strongly commend to you. Here is a lady called Caroline Pomeroy talking in very practical ways about the church's response to the climate crisis. She speaks as an Anglican and as an activist within a movement called Climate Steward, but she works in the responses of churches across the spectrum. She's obviously pretty fit too, fit in the old sense of in good shape physically, as opposed to the more recent sense of fit as in good shape. Quickly extracting foot from mouth, I'll let her explain.
I live and work in Somerset, so a group of us cycled from Wells Cathedral in Somerset to Notre Dame in Paris as part of something called the Pilgrimage to Paris. And when we arrived, we, together with others, we presented a petition to Cristina Figueres, the person who was chairing the climate talks. And as many of you will recall, those Paris climate talks were very significant and very successful. They achieved a commitment to keep global emissions at no more than 2 degrees, in fact, with an ambition to limit that to 1.5 degrees above pre-industrial levels. So, and afterwards, she wrote to all those who had prayed and fasted, many, many of whom would call themselves Christians from all around the world. And she said, thank you. Thank you to all of you, all of civil society, but particularly to the faith groups, for the part in which you played in the run-up to these talks in terms of exerting an influence on your legislators. But I want to talk about what we as churches can do in this terms of the green recovery. What can we do to put our own house in order? It feels very important that we lead from the front, that we walk the talk. So what can we do as churches to walk the talk here? As introduction, last year was a big year. We had 2015 in Paris, and for many of us in the global climate or the national climate movement, we feel that 2019 was a real turning point. You will remember the school strikes for climate, for Greta Thunberg and all of the others who striked. Extinction Rebellion, that's there, and there they were in Oxford Circus, the sort of the high point of consumerism, perhaps. David Attenborough did his thing about climate change, this sort of this time Easter last year. And then later in the year, continued natural responses to climate change, well, disasters really. And this was a photograph from Sydney around about Christmas time when we had the terrible fires. So people, over the course of 2019, it felt like the world woke up to the seriousness and the importance of tackling climate change. It was a huge year. And now, of course, this year, well, we all know where we are now. the challenge is how do we take forward that momentum, I think, from 2019 into beyond the post coronavirus, the post-pandemic, the green recovery. So soon after, and probably or very much contributed to by that, the Church of England declared in February an ambition to be carbon neutral by 2030. Again, many of you have been involved in that perhaps, or certainly been aware of what was going on. You will recall that in the run-up to the General Synod, a huge amount of work had been done to prepare a proposal that the Church should commit itself to being carbon neutral by 2045. In the end, there was a very heated debate. I watched it live on my screen, and there was a real groundswell of opinion that 2045 was not ambitious enough, and the Church of England committed itself to becoming carbon neutral by 2030. It's a hugely ambitious target, and the challenge is to deliver that. But it was felt that without ambition, that they would get nowhere. So that was a really significant starting point, I think, to this year in terms of climate ambition from the churches in the UK. So that was the Church of England in February this year. So the question then is how to deliver that. I'm an Anglican, although I've worshipped in many different denominations, but I'm currently involved with the Diocese of Bath and Wells, as James mentioned. And the conversation obviously immediately turned to how do we achieve that. This graph is one I've made up myself effectively, but it's based on a piece of work that the church did, in fact Leeds Diocese did a couple of years ago. They did some work trying to start getting a feel for what is the carbon footprint of a church. A church as an organisation, so the building and the things that go on within the church. And they came up with, they did a lot of work, they had some spreadsheets, they got people to measure and count their carbon footprint from different activities. And they had sort of two categories of church. There were lots of churches, obviously, but they sort of two sort of example churches. And one was church, this was Church A, which is probably a big, fairly lively, probably urban church with a carbon footprint of 60 tons per year. So the challenge is then, you know, how then does this church with a carbon footprint of 60 tons from its energy consumption, from its transport emissions, from all the other bits and pieces that go on in terms of the life of the church, so that would be food and waste and resources that they're using. How do they get down? And at what point could they call themselves carbon neutral or net zero? At what point do they reach net zero? So there we are, we're starting in 2020 with a footprint of 60 tons. One might imagine that that each year they'll be doing different things. They might change their boiler, they might insulate part of the church, they might cut down on the drafts, they might do a whole series of different things, which little by little, hopefully, will reduce their carbon footprint. When they get to 2030, they will still probably have some carbon footprint. It's very unlikely that they will have got to zero. And that's the point at which it seems to be generally agreed that churches will be encouraged or obliged to offset the rest, to do something about neutralizing, as it were, the remaining carbon footprint. This is a live debate. This is not written in tablets of stone yet, but this is the kind of conversation that's going on amongst the Anglican Church about how to actually achieve net zero and what does that look like and what might they need to do having reduced as far as they can, what do they do with the rest of it. So that's just a little sketch that we drew up as an idea of how they could calculate or how that progression might be seen. Obviously it's unlikely to be in equal steps like that, but that's the trajectory that we want to see. This, I don't expect you to read all of this, but this is a document that Church of England has just produced, and at the bottom I put the web link for it. So this is a practical path to net zero carbon for our churches, which you can find online. I think it's a really helpful first starting point for churches. How do we as a church community start to put our own house in order? As you can see, it's a sort of traffic light system, the green and then the orange and then the red. The simple things are in green. The things that probably won't cost anything and may well save you money are highlighted in green, and they're in different categories. I'm not going to read through it now, but I just want you to be aware that this document exists, and I think it's a very helpful starting point. Not just, it's freely available, you don't have to be an Anglican to read it. And then going through from the green, the simple actions, you can see that the next category, so you start with the dark green, the lighter green are things with a reasonably fast payback for a church with medium energy uses. So the church which is in regular use. Then the paler green, category C on the right-hand side, getting to zero. These are bigger and more complex projects, for example, draft proofing, double glazing, insulation. A lot of them will not be appropriate for many ancient buildings. All of these obviously need to be done in close consultation with your architect or your surveyor and people who understand the building itself. And then the yellow ones are things that we might only do if, for example, we are reordering the church or if the boiler breaks down, in which case we might replace it. And the red ones at the end are, they've categorized those as by exception. So these are things which, for example, installing solar panels, this is not the first port of call. This is if you have the time, the resources, if it fits with the church's plans, that makes sense to do. But there are some much easier things to do. For example, switching to buying renewable energy, which you can do straight away. So it's a kind of a hierarchy of activities that churches might consider in order to move themselves down that scale from a high carbon footprint to a much lower carbon footprint. So that's the Church of England, that's where it's at. It's got a lot of work to do, But the first activity is to start to understand carbon footprints and to measure them. Other church denominations have also made statements publicly about their commitment to reduce their carbon footprint. The Methodist Church has said in July 2019 at their synod, they urged the government to achieve net zero before 2050, and they encouraged churches to sign up for Eco Church or Eco Congregation in Scotland, and then on a bigger scale, Eco Circuits and Eco Districts. The United Reformed Church has pledged to shrink its carbon footprint, and the Catholic Church last year switched an enormous number of its buildings to renewable energy, and that was one of part of its commitment to reduce its carbon footprint. So those are the sort of public pledges. Many other denominations, including those, have made comments about the need to be good stewards, but those are the specific pledges about the buildings and the churches themselves and what they want to do to put their own houses in order. So having given you a little bit of a background on the different denominations, I just wanted to look briefly at some of the tools which might help your church to move in this direction. Obviously, I've no idea who's watching this this broadcast, so some of you may be very familiar with these and some of you less so. So please forgive me if this is old hat, but I hope there'll be something for you to take away. So the first tool, and I think the key one that I would want to encourage you to have a look at, is EcoChurch. This is a toolkit for churches to basically do a sort of audit of their church life in terms of its your responsibility towards the environment. It's free to use, it's available online. It's run and hosted by Arosha UK. Climate Stewards that I work for is part of the Arosha family, but this is an Arosha UK project. If you're in Scotland, there is a similar scheme called Eco Congregation. So take a look at the website. Just to warn you, if you do, Eco Church, because of the current crisis, has had to put some staff on furlough, and currently they are not accepting new registrations for churches. So if you're already registered as a church, you can continue to work on your survey, which is online. But if you wanted to sign up for the first time, at the moment, you can't do that. But please don't give up. All the resources are there, the questionnaire is there, the survey is there, so you can have a really good look and you can do much of the work. You just can't actually register at the moment. They're planning to be back online, I think, in July. So this is Eco Church. It's essentially, at the heart is this survey of church life, which has five categories. First one is worship and teaching. So what is the church teaching in terms of how much is it communicating creation care and care for the environment in from the front, in the sermons, in the small groups, in the children's work, youth work, in your newsletter, all that kind of stuff. What about the songs you sing? Are they do they reflect God's love for the world in what we're singing, how we worship? Managing church buildings, clearly that's a very practical question about whether, and it may be about energy procurement, it may be about big expensive bits of infrastructure, but it may also be things like coffee cups and washing up and compost and things like that. The church land, again, not every church has land, but if you have church land, how do you look after it? Are you thinking about biodiversity? And then community and global engagement. So this is about sort of spreading the word. This is about engaging beyond the borders of the church. How much are we campaigning? How much are we joining local groups? How much are we working together with other local groups on environmental issues? And finally, lifestyle, which perhaps is the most significant of all. If every church member goes home and starts putting some of these things into practice, then that will obviously have a much bigger knock-on effect.
Together, everyone a scene.
time of crisis, it's always nice to have someone to blame, because if something goes wrong, it must be someone's fault, and it obviously isn't ours. I recently ran a feature on the Black Death, which revealed, among other things, how that appalling pandemic led to both literal witch hunts and to a huge rise in anti-Semitism. And it's quite a relief to be able to say that neither Jews nor witches have been held responsible for COVID-19, which doesn't mean to say that other conspiracy theories haven't been hatched. I was shocked to find an article online headlined "The Top 10 COVID Conspiracy Theories," which implies there must be at least two more, and these 10 are weird enough. Take your pick from 1. COVID-19 doesn't exist. It's been invented as a scare story to deprive us of our precious freedoms. 2. It's been cooked up by Bill Gates because he's nuts about vaccinating people against illnesses. Like that ever worked. 3. It's all being manipulated by the deep state to undermine Donald Trump. 4. It's a byproduct of 5G. 5. No, sorry, I mean of genetically modified crops. 6. Oh, all right, it exists, but the death rates have been wildly exaggerated, again by all these sinister control freaks who want to vaccinate us against our will. 7. It originated in America, but found its way into China through US participants in a sporting event held last autumn. 8. It's been invented by Big Pharma so they can sell us their overpriced drugs. 9. It was created as a biological weapon by the Chinese. And 10, it escaped from a Chinese laboratory. I arranged those in what seemed to me increasing levels of plausibility. Tried telling, among others, Boris Johnson that it doesn't exist, or anyone you know who's been seriously ill with it. Who knows if GM crops might hold the key to a successful vaccine, but they can no more have caused the pandemic than witchcraft. There is a finite risk that one day some nasty bug will escape from a laboratory and there'll be no antidote, so it could have been the coronavirus, except we know it wasn't, not this time. Why, might you ask, should anyone believe these theories, especially ones that can't be true? Number of reasons, I think. First, we often feel the need to scapegoat somebody. Second, these theories reinforce our distaste for the named culprit. Like, who needs 5G? When there are plenty of black spots across Yorkshire where you can't get any sort of phone or Wi-Fi signal. Nationwide 4G would be nice, so yeah, let's blame 5G for COVID-19. There, that's better. The theories allow us a starring role because we know something that others don't or don't want us to know, but we are smarter than them, we've rumbled them. They affirm us in our instinctive belief that we know better than the experts, the pundits, the media. They grow out of a sense that we've been lied to in the past, so why not now? And they provide us with an unanswerable circular counter-argument. Oh, they've got to you as well, have they? We can say that to anyone who challenges us. Conspiracies save you the trouble of thinking more deeply and always deflect responsibility away from yourself. Not that you were necessarily responsible, or that anyone was, for such things as natural disasters, but you cannot be a person of interest. They will appeal if they put your favourite bogeyman, bogeywoman, bogey cause in the frame. But fair enough, they also arise because a certain level of scepticism is good for our protection. And sometimes, not infrequently, we are lied to, scammed, spun yarns. Just because Donald Trump calls everything he doesn't agree with fake news doesn't mean there's no such thing as fake news. I got taken in the other week by a story, illustrated with authentic-looking photographs, about millions and millions of cars that can't be sold because the manufacturers never stopped making them all through lockdown, because that would have meant laying workers off, but now people can't afford them, and because they will soon be last year's models, no one will want them even when they can afford them. It sounded entirely plausible, but it was as made up as the accompanying photographs had been digitally manipulated. It wouldn't surprise me if it's an original form it had appeared on April the 1st. Conspiracy theories run the risk of closing off discussion about real conspiracies, about sinister unelected people and groups who may not have committed this particular crime, but that doesn't mean they haven't committed others. For every man in power, there's two that you don't see. Well, did you know that? And with each passing hour, there's
did you know that? So ask yourself this question: who of us is free? And do we dare?
Local lass Leslie Duncan with Sunshine, Send Them Away, from an album that she made with Elton John, doing a lot of the backing work there. I say local, she's from Stockton-on-Tees, but that's near enough, isn't it? It's Leaven Online Radio. Don't say we didn't warn you. Religious beliefs may have the structure of a conspiracy theory. The devil is out to get you, to twist your mind against the truth. Unless you repent of your sins, you'll go to hell, says the evangelist, or certain kinds of evangelist. To which I reply, I don't believe in a devil who is capable of making me think other than I choose to. And the evangelist says, aha, he's got you. Convincing people he doesn't exist is his greatest trick, and there really is no answer to that. Now, that may be a fictitious example, but the following is true. A lady in one particular church was ill and asked for prayers that she might recover. The prayers were made, the illness persisted, and she was then told that was because she didn't have enough faith. There's no answer to that either, but the cruelty of such a reply in the context of a sensitive pastoral situation beggars belief. How is such thinking like a conspiracy theory? Something has happened, or has failed to happen, not for the actual reason, namely that the illness was deeply seated and would have to run its course, as illnesses generally do, but for some other completely spurious reason, which you cannot challenge without seeming to be part of the problem yourself. If, in that situation, I were to say to the prayer group leader, how dare you blame the lady for something that is manifestly not her or anyone else's fault, the answer would be, ah, my son, it is clear your faith is as lacking as hers. It's an impenetrable mindset and very, very insidious. Conspiracy theories are a frequent recourse of the lazy-minded in many contexts, religious, yes, but also political and across the media, and it is in their nature to render themselves immune to analysis. They're a kind of collective paranoia. Of course they're up to get me, to lie to me, to deceive me. And if you don't believe me, it means you're one of them. I call this story fake news, and if you believe it, you're part of the deception. Beware, beware, do your fact-checking, turn up your scepticism, ask what the ulterior motives might be, who's paying for that research, what was his fee for giving that endorsement, and apply that to everything, reviews on Amazon and TripAdvisor, to the latest inflammatory bilge in the Daily Red Top. That sort of approach will usually run to ground the most dangerous conspiracy theorists right now, those who deny the urgency, the reality of the climate crisis. Reckon it's all a con job by scientists in the pay of nasty socialists, Swedish schoolgirls, and the enemies of freedom in general. They almost invariably fall into two camps, the ideological and the economic. It's recognised that if we do indeed need to take urgent action to prevent global warming, that will put a serious dampener on many of the industries that currently generate our wealth. But I am a capitalist entrepreneur, so stuff that. I am an oil magnate. I am not going to have people burning less of what has made me my billions. And if action has to be taken, it can only be on a global scale by nations working in partnership. But I am not an internationalist. My motto is make my country great again. Whether it's America or Brazil or Turkey or the Faroe Islands, I'm having none of this snowflakey, woke, politically correct, multiracial claptrap. And what's more, I believe in individual freedom and a small state. Tackling the environmental crisis would require big government interventions and big government funding, just like we've seen through the COVID crisis, and we've had quite enough of that. So, if that's what tackling the crisis means, well, there can't be a crisis, because it can't be right to have a big state, burn less oil, restrict individual freedom. Global warming can't be as bad as they say. Or if it is, it can't be humanity's fault. Or actually, it could be beneficial. And lo and behold, whenever you find a think tank devoted to discrediting environmental science, you will find oil company funding, you will find far-right political funding, you will find billionaire funding, but what you won't find is authentic, peer-reviewed, validated science, because that will tell you the truth. There is a crisis, it's not going away, and there are only two questions we need to discuss. First, how much time have we got? And second, what are our priorities in the struggle against global overheating? Oh, all right, three questions. How are we going to fund those priorities? I can't trace the person who said of some bunch of scoundrels that they were as innocent as serpents and as wise as doves, but it describes conspiracy theorists to a T. Needless to say, we must counter them by embracing the opposite values, the biblical ones. We must be on our guard against our own ulterior motives, against believing what it would be convenient to believe, whether or not it's true, and no less sceptical of others, because we recognise in them the same tendencies in ourselves, the wish to deflect blame and responsibility onto others, to avoid action that would inconvenience us. But sometimes the truth is that when there's a crisis, and whether or not it was anyone else's fault in the past, the onus now is to act on not what we would like to be true, but on what is true.
My head to the
Every year, the Methodist Conference, which has just been meeting, hosts something called the Beckley Lecture, which takes a topical issue or current concern and invites someone of eminence to reflect on it theologically. This year, the lecturer, online needless to say, was the Reverend Inderjit Bogal, who has been the president of conference and gone on to do all manner of worthy things in terms of peace building, interfaith dialogue, work on the environmental crisis and much else. So it almost feels that this year he couldn't decide on any one topic but linked several together under his title of Peace, Pandemics and Plastic Bottles. The lecture, which you can find on YouTube, deals with each of those separately and explores the connection between them. The part I'm going to play you is as passionate and uncomfortable as any. It's the one dealing with racial justice and institutional racism. And as a white man who has spent his life in mostly white communities, I find this a challenging listen, but for that very reason, I commend it to you, and I'll follow that with a simple poem about why black lives matter.
It is never too late to commit oneself to building a better world, a world governed by justice, mercy, and humility. In church, it is always urgent to nurture the church as the body of Christ, where bruised, broken, and beautiful, all are equally welcome, equally valued, belong equally, truly reflecting all of us with our wondrous diversity in congregations and leadership, where all are worthy and no one is made to feel unworthy, where we rejoice in the fact that we are all human beings made in the image of God, one human race, one in Christ. All peace organizations have to relate peace to the global pandemic and anger in matters of racism and air. Black Lives Matter has become a global message. The largest groups on the streets prior to the Black Lives Matter protests centered on climate change. Greta Thunberg draws attention of the world to the pandemic of climate crisis. Treat climate crisis like the crisis it is and give us a future, she insists. Wars create refugees. There are almost 80 million displaced people now. 90% of the people crossing borders for safety are people from countries in or close to conflict. This is the shameful reality of war. Stories around Noah and the flood and the rainbow suggest that the relationship between humans and the environment is integral to peace and well-being. There are religious tensions around which is the most favored faith in the eyes of God. One suggestion explores sibling rivalry and the choices held out in the situations of Isaac, but not Ishmael, Jacob, but not Esau. These stories raise the question, who is the best? They hold up the option of superiors and inferiors. The stories in Hebrew scriptures pose the question, can it be true that though we are all made in the image of God, I am good, but not you. God loves me, but not you. Perhaps the key insight in the Adam and Eve story is that mutuality is central to all relationships and is bruised by selfishness, seeking only my satisfaction. Human beings have this in common, that selfishness mars our highest ideals. The question raised, how can we build peace and the best for ourselves and also for others? What is required to love your neighbor as yourself? There are important challenges that face us at local, national, and international level to pursue the path of peace. We can all play our part, for example, by being human and hospitable and always challenging hatred. See the image of God in the other, the stranger. Try to experience conflict from the perspective of the victim. Learn and always seek non-violent ways of conflict resolution.
So I want to turn now to what I call the storm of the pandemics. COVID-19 has clarified for me wider pandemics, deeper diseases and wounds in human beings and the environment around us, namely hatred and climate degradation.
There has to be international cooperation to find cures and ways through the coronavirus pandemic and ways to prevent the spread of similar outbreaks of disease. This is important and urgent, but the focus entirely on the virus in this pandemic is to look for the cause and the cure of the storm in the waves rather than in the direction of the wind. Jesus rebuked the wind to still the storm. What is the wind we are to rebuke if we are to achieve some semblance of peace? For me, the wind to rebuke includes two deeper pandemics: hatred between human beings based on difference and iniquitous inequalities, and climate degradation and change that threatens us all. So let's look at these two pandemics, wounds that cry out for healing. First, we look at hatred. We have to find ways to address human hatred that divides us. We can do this by being human with each other and by accommodating each other as human with our differences. This is the first restart button to press. In my experience of ministry, we have been wrestling with this in the Methodist Church in Britain for 40 years, and the struggle continues. When I was ordained, there were only 5 Black Methodist presbyters in Britain. 5 years into ministry, I helped to initiate the Black Methodist Ministers Group, now called the Belonging Together Ministers Group, recognizing our diversity. The primary purpose of the group was to meet together to share experience, to further education, and to support each other to be more effective in ministry. Stephen Lawrence, a young Black Methodist, was murdered in a London street on the 22nd of April in 1993. Stephen's mother, Baroness Doreen Lawrence, has championed the cause of racial justice in Britain, and I was proud to invite her to address the conference when I was president. She spoke passionately about the need for justice and change. Here we are in 2020. We have made some progress, but we have an unfinished agenda. We must move beyond the white male-dominated model of church, which is so 19th century. George Floyd's murder has named the endemic inequalities faced by Black and minority ethnic communities in daily in health, in housing, education, and employment, migration, as racism. Why would our government want to create a hostile environment within immigration? And why treat the Windrush generation with such deep injustice and hostility? Why hostile? What does that do to fan wider hostility? The COVID-19 pandemic has uncovered the deep sickness of hatred and resulting inequalities of racism and the harm it does. We see that, for example, in the disproportionate number of people of Asian and African backgrounds who have died from COVID-19 in the UK and the USA. These groups of people are more affected, not only because they have been among the frontline carers, and in the words of a Public Health England report, amongst those who are in proximity to the infections and in occupations that are more likely to be exposed, but also because they were the least well protected. Many of them were also people from overseas on fragile work visas, who were also being required to pay an NHS levy for care themselves until this was reversed following a public outcry. These are the very people who have been the least valued and often the most vilified in opinions, who have been more likely to be undertaking virus-facing care work in hospitals and care homes, and who on Thursdays we applauded. Those at the deepest end of racist violence and abuse anywhere are black people. The darker your skin, the deeper you're hurt. This is a global fact in every community and in every walk of life. For me, tackling racism at its worst begins with tackling hatred, deeply rooted in concepts of racial differences and in which religious belief is so often co-opted to sanction hatred. I delight in human diversity. Human DNA shows an incredible mixing and intermingling amongst human beings throughout history. There is a fantastic variety in skin colors and deep visual beauty in them all. The skin color referred to as white is incredibly variable, as is the skin color of people of Asian or African or Aboriginal people of any nation. We reduce these variables to black and white. This remarkable diversity of people rooted in the global South is reduced to BAME, black and minority ethnic. That's like labeling all the immense variety of Indian cuisine as curry, which is as ludicrous as labeling all British food as gravy. There is no scientific basis to the argument that there are different races with one group superior to another. Science is affirming what theology has always insisted. Human beings are not people of different races. We should stop using terms like multiracial and mixed race. They don't make sense. Of course, we all carry the capacity for selfishness and have our biases and prejudice, and we hurt each other. But within our immense differences, we are one human race and incredibly alike. Life is precious to us all. We all require breath and blood in our bodies. Whoever you are, your well-being will be checked against the same rate of heartbeat and pulse. How did skin color come to be so embedded in discrimination? Of course, for our reflections, of significance for our reflections is the fact that, to quote a scholar in genetics, the emergence of scientific approach to human taxonomy coincided with the growth of European empires. Characterizing of different populations before the expansion of Europeans around the globe was more likely to be based on religion or language than on skin color. But with the birth and the growth of the era of scientific revolution, pigmentation became integral to the character of humans. Skin color came to be used to exercise power and prejudice to other human beings of a different and particularly darker skin tone, and to sanction subjugation of people. This development was integral to the development of the transatlantic slave trade 400 years ago and the subsequent history of racism. It is far easier to sell the case for occupation and enslavement if you are persuaded that the indigenous people are different, have different origins, and are qualitatively inferior to colonists. Scholars in the so-called Enlightenment period of history, the period of empire building and colonial expansion, helped to formulate the idea of fixed differences in human beings, primarily based on skin color, linking skin color to character and the ranking of human beings. Those with lighter skins were said to be more superior to those with darker skins. Here lie the roots of the supremacy of the color white. The idea of different races based on skin color was developed. Contemporary science has rejected these classifications, though they persist in many people's minds and views and opinions. Where we are now is that sciences refuse to show linear, discrete categorization of human beings. Rather, it reveals complexity in human history and life, which only increases with the movement, meandering, and migrations of people across the globe from about 70,000 years ago. The baseline of the most recent science of human genetics is that all human beings share all their DNA, and of all the attempts over the centuries to place humans in distinct races, none succeeds. Genetics refuses to comply with these artificial and superficial categories. While theology insists we are all made in the image of God, it is a sacrilege that religion has introduced the idea of clean and dirty, holy and profane into the mix. People who are like us are clean, others are dirty. Whiteness is good and pure, blackness is seen negatively. White has come to be associated with power and privilege and goodness, black with subjugation, denial and badness. I reject this reasoning. Black is beautiful. This is why it is important to stand by Black Lives Matter. To recognize Black Lives Matter is to agree all lives matter. Racism is an obscenity, a negation of our humanity. It is a painful form of violence which is dehumanizing and degrading. We all have to stand and work together, all of us, with all our skin variables, to resist and stop racism. Stop stereotyping people. Take a persistent stand against racism. The most repeated ethical command in the Bible, to love the stranger, challenges us all to see the image of God in those who are different from us.
Let us stand shoulder to shoulder. Let us walk side by side. Let us not be divided. Let us in God abide. Let us all come together. Let us fight the good fight. Let us combat the evil. Let us all unite. Let's speak up for each other. Let us right the wrongs. Let us not be silent. Let us stand and be strong. Let us call out the evil that is hidden in plain sight and corrupting the people for their evil delight. Let us campaign for justice, for our laws and our rights. Let us not lose this moment. Let us focus our sight. Let us speak to the strongholds that they have to come down. They're not working for us. No righteousness can be found. Let us cover each other with love. Let us partner with truth. Train ourselves and our children and save our black youth. Teach the way of God's love, effective, robust and true. Keep humanity victorious. Banish the inhumane few. For George Floyd's life, the world has been shaken. The culmination of thousands of black lives viciously taken. May the presence of evil be squashed by great love, suffocated under masks of schemes, lies and cover-up gloves. COVID-19 has ravaged and devoured its prey. But your end will be soon. Ignorance can no longer stay. Let us work shoulder to shoulder and seize the day. Racism has been uncovered. People, open your eyes. Grasp the hope and the future. So we can all rise. Let's embrace black and white and the colours within. Let us bring forth forgiveness. Let us learn from the past. Let us be good to each other. Let's build trust. Amen? Crush the enemy of all. let us all breathe again.
And on that note, we are done for another week, so it's goodbye from me, and may all be well with you. My name is Richard Bradshaw, but yours isn't.